Okay, last week I introduced the class. Our class is the Bible and Homosexual Conduct. Last week I introduced it, and I hope I made clear why the class and the subject is so important. Homosexuals and their allies are insisting that the church accept in its fellowship those who are actively and impenitently engaged in homosexual conduct. And as I said, the question is not whether the church should receive into its fellowship those who simply are attracted to the same sex, those who struggle with the temptation to sin posed by that attraction, as we all struggle against temptation posed by other attractions. Rather, the question is whether the church should receive into its fellowship those who are impenitently engaged in homosexual conduct. And the church cannot do that. The church cannot do that because to do so would be to defy the will of God revealed in Holy Scripture, as I'll make clear during the course of the study. And to do that would cut us off from God and we would cease to be a church of Christ. So we cannot do that. But that is what we're being pushed to do in this culture. This is being, the church is being challenged to do this. Now, when we ended last week, I made the point that God loves all people. The question is not, does God love homosexuals? God wrote his love for homosexuals and all people in blood on a cross. So there's no question that God loves all people. He loves homosexuals. The question is whether the homosexual will love God. Part of which is submitting to the will of God, as I showed you in a number of texts last week. Now, this morning, we're going to begin looking at what the Old Testament has to say on this subject, on the subject of homosexual conduct. And this will occupy us for a number of weeks, and we will begin, as you might imagine, in the beginning. But I have a couple of, before we get started, I have a couple of programming notes. Lord willing, Meg and I will be in Colorado Springs next Sunday, visiting the world's cutest grandchildren, I might add. But we'll be there, and Scott Van Wormer has kindly agreed to teach in my stead. Now, he is, at my request, going to teach something other than the Bible and homosexual conduct. I'm kind of doing something here, so I said, would you teach something other than that? So he's agreed to do that, and I'll pick back up this study with the lesson three the Sunday after Christmas. Now, the other note is that Steve Hubbard's class is going to be joining us for this study. There's Steve sitting over there. So his class, he's been teaching on the science and Genesis. But when we conclude the study of homosexual conduct, which I don't know how long it's going to take, he asked me, and I said, I never know. I'm going to guess 7 or 8 weeks, but we'll see. And then when we conclude that, then they're going to resume that class. Okay, Genesis chapter 2. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, God declares that it's not good for the man to be alone, and then he announces his intention to make or to create a helper who is fit for or corresponds to or pairs up with Adam. And then in chapter 2 of Genesis, verses 21 and 22, he fulfills that intention. Not by independently creating another man, but by building a woman, a sexual counterpart to the man from the bone and flesh that he removed from Adam. The woman was created from Adam, as Paul mentions in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 8. And she is a complementary fit to him. What the New Testament scholar Robert Gagnon calls a complementary sexual other. Now, Gagnon is, by the way, he's a teaches at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary, but he's perhaps the world's leading scholar on the subject of the Bible and homosexual practice, having written his dissertation on the subject, having written 2 books on the subject, and having written countless articles and book chapters on the subject. Now, if you're familiar with his work, you will recognize my debt to him. And so I announce that up front. I've benefited from his work significantly. Now, when the woman is brought to Adam, having been created, when the woman is brought to Adam, He acknowledges her in Genesis chapter 2, verse 23, as being right or suitable or fit for him, having been made from him. And then the very next verse, Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, declares, "Therefore, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." It is because of the complementary fit of man and woman, based on the fact woman was created out of the man. It's because of this complementary fit that man and woman join back together in the sexual union of marriage. She was created as a complementary fit out of the man, and for that reason, she is a complementary sexual other, and then they join back together in the one flesh union of marriage. Male and female are perfect fits from the standpoint of divine design and blessing. Male and male and female are not. And as we'll see, this justification for male-female union, this complementarity that's rooted in the woman coming out of the man, is a thread running through the criticisms in Scripture of same-sex intercourse as contrary to nature, meaning contrary to God's creative design and intention. And from this foundation in Genesis, of God creating complementary sexes, the woman having been created out of the man as a fit for the man, from this foundation in Genesis, the Bible is a thoroughly heterosexual book. Thoroughly heterosexual. Robert Gagnon says, "Indeed, every narrative, law, proverb, exhortation, poetry, and metaphor in the pages of Scripture that has anything to do with sexual relations presupposes a male-female prerequisite for sexual relations and marriage." The Lord Jesus, he appealed to this Genesis text in Matthew chapter 19, verses 4 through 6, and in the parallel in Mark chapter 10. He appealed to this text in responding to the Pharisees' question about divorce. And Jesus said, it is because God created two sexes in the beginning, male and female, that a man and a woman are joined by God in the one flesh union of marriage, and having been so joined are not to be separated by divorce. So he's responding to their question about divorce, but in the process of doing that, he says it's because God created them male and female, that he joins them in the one sex union of marriage. According to Jesus, marriage and the sexual intimacy that are part of marriage are intended by God to be between the two sexes he created in the beginning, male and female. Therefore, they're joined by God together in the one-sex union of marriage. He created the male and female, therefore they're joined. So Jesus looks at the Genesis text and cites it this way. Now it's interesting to me, at least, that those who are intent on having the church embrace homosexual conduct, they generally limit their claim, as I said last week, at least for now, but they generally limit their claim to persons engaging in homosexual conduct in committed monogamous relationships. In other words, exclusive. There's just two of them. That's where they draw the line. Even they accept that those engaging in homosexual conduct outside of an exclusive committed relationship, they would acknowledge, well, that's wrong and that's sinful. Now, I say it's interesting because these advocates, they agree that God approves of sexual relations only in the context of committed exclusive relationships. But how do they know that? How do they know that? Well, they know that from the fact the one flesh marriage relationship that God established at the beginning with Adam and Eve involved only two parties, Adam and Eve. So what they wind up doing, they pick the exclusive commitment aspect of that relationship as something that's clear and something that's binding, but they reject the heterosexual aspect of that relationship, which is no less clear and binding. So it's an interesting kind of inconsistency that they have to glom on to that text and say, I'm only talking about exclusive because there are only two. You say, okay, I get that, but do you not see that those two were heterosexual, male and female, he made in the beginning? But they don't really pay attention to those kinds of things. Now, God's aversion, his aversion to obscuring the male-female sexual differences that he established at creation, that is evident in his prohibition against cross-dressing. In Deuteronomy 22, verse 5, it says, a woman shall not wear a man's garment, nor shall a man put on a woman's cloak, for whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord your God. Now, you understand that there are cultural factors involved in what is the dress of a man and the dress of a woman. Okay, but we're still at the point now, you'd see that for a man to wear a dress would be dressing like a woman. Now, they will push to get rid of that distinction, by the way, but that one still holds. But do you see here is this thing about cross-dressing, and you see it, if a male-female distinction, if that distinction from creation is so fundamental that disregarding or camouflaging it by dressing like the opposite sex is sinful, then certainly disregarding the male-female distinction by taking the role of the opposite sex in sexual intercourse is sinful. If ignoring that distinction or camouflaging that distinction by dressing like the opposite sex, if that distinction is so fundamental and so significant to God that he doesn't want you to blur it by dressing like the opposite sex, well then certainly taking the role of the other sex in sexual conduct is sinful. And you see that clearly in the Mosaic law. The laws are unqualified and absolute. Leviticus 18:22 and Leviticus chapter 20, verse 13. Leviticus 18:22, you shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. Leviticus 20:13, if a man lies with a male as with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood is upon them. So here you have these unqualified, absolute condemnations of homosexual conduct. Now the verses say that if a man lies with a male as with a woman, it doesn't say if a man lies with a male who is his neighbor, or a boy, if a man lies with a male who is a cult prostitute, or a male who is a slave, or a male who is a stranger, or is a male he doesn't love. It doesn't say that. The determining factor in the condemnation is the sex of the participants. It's the sex of the participants, not their social status, not their relationship. The offense is a man lying with a male as with a woman. It is treating a man sexually as a woman, which is a violation of God's creative design and intention that only complementary sexes, only male and female, join together in one flesh union. The sex of the participants is the operative thing. It's a distortion and a rejection of the male-female distinction as created and ordered by God for male, male, female, female to engage in sexual conduct. Now, in the words of the Old Testament scholar Michael Grisanti, he says, the practice of a man lying with another man after the manner of lying with a woman, that's Baruch Levine's translation of that, as with a woman, just his elaboration on it, was abhorrent to Yahweh because it perverted the heterosexual relationship ordained by him. And that's why we start in Genesis. That's the foundation of what's going on. Now, Brevard Childs was a very influential theologian. He was a longtime professor of Old Testament at Yale University. Brevard Childs says, "The recent attempt of some theologians to find a biblical opening, if not warrant, for the practice of homosexuality stands in striking disharmony with the Old Testament's understanding of the relation of male and female. The theological issue goes far beyond the citing of occasional texts which condemn the practice. It goes to the foundation, to this fundamental creative distinction of male and female. These condemnations are simply a reflection of that distinction that God created in the beginning." So that's what he's talking about. He says the Old Testament views homosexuality as a distortion of creation, which falls into the shadows outside the blessing. Now, these laws, it says that if a man lies with a male, and they say that if a man lies with a male as with a woman, not if a man rapes or otherwise coerces a male into sexual relations, lies with is simply a way of saying has sex with. It's analogous to our sleeps with. Right? When we say somebody sleeps with somebody, that's what lies with is. Everybody understands that lies with carries no connotation of coercion. In the other uses of lies with, right in Leviticus chapter 20, where condemnation is announced on a man in verse 11 who lies with his father's wife. And condemnation is announced on a man in verse 12 who lies with his daughter-in-law. Now, nobody argues in those contexts that these commands prohibit only rape or only some kind of coercive form of sex, that they somehow exempt voluntary sex. Nobody thinks that. Nobody argues that. So there's no reason to think that the condemnation of a man who lies with a male, that carries some kind of restriction like that, that it's only rape or it's only coercive. No, it just means having sex, just as it does in the other cases in Leviticus 20 that you recognize. It simply says a man who lies with, has sex with a male, who lies with a male as with a woman, who has sex with a male. Indeed, the fact that both participants are to be put to death. You see that it says here, that both of them have committed. If a man lies with a male as a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall be put to death. Their blood is upon them. That means they're both culpable. Their blood is upon them. They both are responsible. They both are culpable. Which shows that the text are in fact referring to voluntary sex between the men. They're both culpable and responsible. Now, the gravity of the sin of homosexual conduct is evident in the description of it as an abomination. It is referred to in both Leviticus 18:22, Leviticus 20:13 as an abomination, tovah. And that shows the gravity of the sin, as does the specification of the death penalty for it. In Leviticus chapter 20, verse 13, a standard Hebrew lexicon, Kohler and Baumgartner, it offers these additional definitions of the word that's translated abomination. An abhorrent thing, something detestable, loathsome, utterly repugnant, disgusting. You see, now, though a number of sexual sins and other sins are mentioned in Leviticus chapter 18 and Leviticus chapter 20, including incest, adultery, bestiality, and child sacrifice, it is only the homosexual act that is specifically designated an abomination. Now, collectively, they're all referred to in the plural as abominations in Leviticus 18, 26 to 29. But in these Leviticus chapters, in Leviticus 18 and Leviticus 20, that designation in the singular, an abomination, is attached only to the homosexual act. It is an abomination par excellence. You see, That's an indication of the degree of divine revulsion over this. It is that fundamental, that foundational, that significant to God that His distinction created between the sexes be honored, that it is called an abomination. And if I may digress briefly, the idea that all sins are equally offensive to God in all respects, that all are equally bad in all ways, is not true. It is not true. Just an example. Matthew 23, verse 23, Jesus refers to the weightier things of the law, the more important things in the will of God. He spoke earlier in Matthew chapter 5 of the lesser commandments, and He speaks in Matthew 22 of the great and first commandment. The sin of Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis 18:20 is called very grave. Israel's sin with the golden calf is called a great sin. In Exodus 32, the sin of Eli's sons is called very great. In 1 Samuel 2:17, and the sin of the northern tribes of Israel under Jeroboam is called great sin. In 2 Kings 17:21, God speaks to Ezekiel of great and greater abominations in Ezekiel chapter 8, verses 5 to 15. And Paul leaves no doubt in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, 1 and 2, that incest in the form of a man lying with his father's wife was a particularly great offense. He says this is something even the pagans don't put up with. This is in that category. You see? No aspect of God's will is trivial. No aspect of God's will is unimportant or insignificant, but some things are more central. Some things are more important. The fact that all unforgiven sin will exclude one from eternal life with God doesn't mean that all sins are equally offensive to God in all respects. I mean, looking at a woman with lust, that's sinful. But it's a less serious sin than raping her. Stealing a tomato from your neighbor's garden is sinful. But it's a less serious sin than torturing his child. Being angry with a brother is sinful, but it's a less serious sin than chopping him into pieces. You see, there are differences. There are differences. Some things are weightier. Now, homosexual activists, they sometimes attempt to put the church on the defensive and to weaken its resistance to their sin by claiming, look, the church is wrong to distinguish homosexual conduct in any way, shape, or form. You shouldn't talk about it more than anything else at all. But let me say, and there are a couple of points to say about that. It is distinguishable from other sins. First, in the fact that there's an organized attempt in our society to redefine homosexual conduct as not being sinful. Now, if you had a push where everybody was saying, no, this isn't sinful. Church, you have to accept this. You have to accept this. Well, then wise pastoral judgment would say that we need to talk about that because that's being pushed. Okay, but beyond that, it's also true that as Gagnon points out, the Bible gives many indications that homosexual practice is regarded as a particularly severe sexual offense. That's why the death penalty is connected to it. But Gagnon lists about six other reasons for seeing that it is a particularly severe sexual offense. Now, some advocates of homosexual unions, they try to get around these, as you can imagine. You know, they try to get around these texts in Leviticus, these laws, by saying, look, they were temporary purity regulations for the people of Israel during the time of the Mosaic Covenant. Yes, I see them there. Yes, I see what they say. But those were just temporary purity regulations. You see, they were matters of ritual contamination for the Jews rather than a matter of immoral conduct. You see, there were just these like ritual contamination kind of thing that only applied to Jews and only applied during the era of the Mosaic Covenant. With the coming of the New Covenant, those things no longer have applicability. Well, that's not true. That's not true at all. Now, it's true that some of the commands of the Mosaic Law were peculiarly covenantal, and as such were in force or applied only to Israel, and were in force only during the period of the Mosaic Covenant. But there are also many commands in the Mosaic Law that reflect the permanent moral desires of God. Who can doubt that? For example, in Leviticus chapters 18 through 20, it includes prohibitions against idolatry, witchcraft, stealing, lying, adultery, incest, bestiality, and child sacrifice. And it commands people to honor one's parents and to love one's neighbor as oneself. And all of that's recognized as having what? Ongoing applicability. All of those commands are recognized as having ongoing and general applicability. And the Levitical prohibition against homosexual conduct is like those prohibitions. And unlike the prohibitions such as touching the carcass of an unclean animal, like you see in Leviticus chapter 5 and Leviticus chapter 11. Now, why think that? A number of reasons, not wishful thinking. Why think that homosexual prohibition is more like those than like touching the carcass of an unclean animal? One of these matters of ritual purity. Well, first, the prohibition of homosexual conduct is grounded in the creation order. It's grounded in the differentiation between male and female at creation. In Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 to 24, as the Jewish scholar Tikva Frymakinsky, who died a few years ago, says, the extreme prohibition of homosexuality by the death penalty, not inherited, by the way, from other ancient Near Eastern laws, is best explained as a desire to keep the categories of male and female intact. Those categories, those distinctions, those creation differences from the very beginning are foundational. And since it's rooted in the creation, that obviously predates the formation of Israel and the giving of the Mosaic Law. So the first thing, well, do you think these are just ritual purity things that were only for Israel and they were only during the time of... No, because they're rooted in something that long predates that. That's the first reason I don't think that's the right way to understand it. And then second, the Levitical laws proscribing homosexual conduct, they are grouped with prohibitions against incest, adultery, and bestiality, offenses that are recognized as having ongoing and general applicability. This grouping, putting the prohibition against homosexual conduct with those, at the very least, creates a presumption that the prohibition of homosexual conduct likewise has ongoing and general applicability, and there's no contrary evidence to dispel that presumption. There's nothing to say, okay, yeah, it looks like that. It's being grouped with those. It looks like it's treated that way. But over here, you can see that's clearly not the case. No, there's nothing. There's no but. They're grouped that way. And there's nothing to dispel that presumption. Third, and this is very important, the prohibition against homosexual conduct is universal. It's universal, and it is not something that applied only to the people of Israel. Well, that's very important because the idea is, no, this is just part of the covenantal requirements that were peculiar to Israel and only applied to Israel during the time of the Mosaic Covenant. But that's not true. They applied beyond Israel. And you can see that from the fact that God, in Leviticus chapter 18, verse 22, He calls homosexual conduct an abomination. And then in Leviticus chapter 18, verses 24 through 30, He explains that He punished the Canaanites, vomited the Canaanites out of the land for engaging in all of the aforesaid abominations. He held them accountable for violating those prohibitions, one of which is the abomination par excellence, homosexual conduct. And in saying that, he vomited them out, the Canaanites out of the land for the aforesaid abominations, he specifically labels them in verse 25, iniquity. He labels them iniquity. Some translations may have, or sin, or guilt, or wickedness. A word that has moral connotations to it. God doesn't judge the nations for eating unclean animals, or for sowing fields with different kinds of seed. He doesn't condemn other nations for violating those covenantal requirements specific to Israel, but he does judge them for engaging in sexual sin like homosexual conduct. So in this idea of this argument, well, it's just these ritual things that only apply to Israel during... No, you see, that's not true. That's just somebody's wishful thinking where they're trying to confuse people. Oh, I never thought about that. Because they know people don't really understand a lot about the transition between the old... So you see? Okay, well then what do I know? Let's just throw that out. But that's not true. That's not true. I want you to see that. And fourth, the fact that engaging in homosexual conduct warranted the death penalty under the Mosaic Covenant, that shows that it is a grave moral offense and not merely a matter of ritual contamination. Here's what the New Testament scholar William Webb says. The placement of homosexuality on the death penalty list argues strongly for the ongoing applicability of divine displeasure against this act in any culture at any time. You see, this is something that's a death penalty offense. This is an abomination. This is serious. This isn't something where I don't care. No, this is serious business. Serious business. And let me address a canard that comes up often. This, by the way, the fact that it's a death penalty offense does not mean that Christians must support the death penalty for homosexual conduct. People say, well, all right, Bible says that. You believe that? You believe that? Oh, I don't know what to say. Okay, I'll throw the Bible in the trash. No, it doesn't mean that at all, that Christians have to support the death penalty for homosexual conduct. See, since the church... the people of God are no longer a nation state like Israel, but are scattered where? Just scattered among all the nations of the world. We are everywhere. We are not a nation state. So the obligation, you see, that was imposed by God on Israel to mete out certain penalties for various sins doesn't apply to the church. That obligation was tied to the fact Israel was a nation. Israel was a civil government. Here's what Tim Keller says. The church is not a civil government, and so sins are dealt with by exhortation and, at worst, exclusion from membership. This is how Paul deals with a case of incest in the Corinthian church. That's very significant. Because Leviticus chapter 20, verse 11, it's the death penalty for a man who has sex with his father's wife. In Corinth, there was a man having sex with his father's wife, and what is the reaction? No death penalty, disfellowship. Why is that? It is because the church is not a nation state. Okay? So when you read these things and people say, well, you got to go for the death. No. It is because I understand how the covenants work and how there's a transition. And see, people prey on these misunderstandings to try to confuse people. And I don't like that. But here's the thing, so I want you to see that I think that's very important. And you see that, so I didn't finish the quote. He says, why this change? Under Christ, the gospel is not confined to a single nation. It has been released to go into all cultures and peoples. And moreover, by the way, it's quite possible that with the exception of premeditated murder, perpetrators of capital crimes under the Mosaic law, they could have their death sentences commuted by offering a ransom or a substitute. This is at least the conclusion of many Old Testament scholars based on Numbers chapter 35, verses 30 to 32. A number of people draw from that this inference that except for premeditated murder, those who committed death crimes could have their sentences commuted. So you have that idea, but you also have this very clear idea that the church is not a nation state, and the meting out specific penalties for things were tied to the existence of Israel as a nation state. We have Paul's example in Corinth. Okay? So no apology about it. And I sit here and say, well, I don't know. I guess I am just inconsistent and the Bible doesn't make any sense. No. Bible makes complete sense. Here's how Robert Gagnon summarizes his rejection of this claim that these commands in Leviticus really don't apply today because it's just a matter of ritual purity, impurity that applied to Israel during the Mosaic era. Here's what he says. I would summarize the matter as follows. The framers of the sexual prohibitions in Leviticus 18 and 20 specifically refer to the forbidden sex acts as iniquity or sin, not just ritual uncleanness, that's in 18:25. Do not permit absolution merely through ritual acts. You know, like if you touch a carcass or something, you do something, you... All right. Number three, do not treat the sexual offenses in chapter 18 and 20 as making the participants contagious to touch. So if I become unclean, I can transmit that to other people through touch. Do not penalize persons for events without willful intent. Even if I don't know something, I back up on something, step on something. If it's unclean, I'm ritually unclean. There's a distinction. Give an implicit rationale for each prohibition and apply the prohibitions not just to Jews, but to resident aliens, Gentiles as well. That was what I was telling you about all these abominations. So it's clear. It's clear that that argument is something that's concocted to get around what is being said. But on top of all of that, is the fact that the prohibition against homosexual conduct is repeated in the New Testament. It's repeated in the New Testament, as we will see, and that establishes conclusively that it is part of God's ongoing or continuing will and not a temporary requirement for Israel during the Mosaic covenant. It is blindness to claim otherwise. And yet people are so invested in wanting this to be the way it is, they claim otherwise. Now, one of the things they try, some try to pull this into the prohibition, the Levitical condemnation of homosexual conduct. They try to pull that into the temporary ritual category by asserting that the prohibition is based on the fact that homosexual intercourse mingles semen and excrement, which are ritually defiling substances. So they say within these two are mingled together, that's what it's about. It's a ritual defilement thing, and therefore it's a temporary regulation, and they allege it therefore has no ongoing applicability. There is no basis for applying that prohibition today. But of course, the premise is simply made up. The premise is simply concocted. The prohibition against homosexual conduct, it makes no mention of excrement. But rather it speaks explicitly of gender discomplementarity. A man lies with a male as with a woman. It speaks specifically of gender discomplementarity, rooted in the creation account where God made the woman as the perfect fit for man, made her from the man. That's what it's rooted in. Moreover, there are things that are prohibited that have nothing to do in Leviticus, that have nothing to do with commingling defiling substances, such as adultery, such as incest. So trying to, you know, bring this idea to just fabricate this notion and say that therefore it doesn't apply, well, you've just made the whole thing up. And you've gone contrary to what's clearly in the text about gender discomplementarity. So that's something that's not right. And also, you see, if other things that would mix semen with excrement, they're not mentioned, okay? Such as heterosexual anal intercourse, which if that were the rationale, right? If the rationale for the prohibition was that that's a ritual uncleanness and that's, well, that would be mentioned. But it's not, and all of those things are telling you that's not the rationale. Despite the, in addition, you got the fact it specifically identifies gender discomplementarity as the reason. So, but this is one of the things that you'll hear. One of the things, and see, if you're not alerted to these things, if you don't hear these things and haven't thought about them, well, especially young people, this is what I'm telling you. They go somewhere and hear somebody go, well, I never thought about that. Wow. Why didn't anybody ever tell me this? It's the same thing you face when they confront issues about evolution and creation and all these things. If they are not armed and do not hear these things, they are vulnerable. And you have to explain to them fairly, this is the argument and this is why this argument is wet. You see, this is why it doesn't fly. And then you go, okay, I've heard that and I understand and I know that there's something to address that. Now, there are others who attempt to deny the undeniable, to deny the fact that the ban on homosexual conduct continues into the new covenant. I say it's undeniable because we'll look at what Paul says. But there are others who attempt to deny that by arguing that the prohibition of homosexual conduct, it's really analogous to the prohibition against having sex with a woman during her period. Leviticus 18, 19 and Leviticus chapter 20, verse 18. You see, they claim that the two offenses are so similar in the relevant particulars that they must be treated the same with regard to their ongoing applicability in the new covenant. So they're so similar they have to be treated the same with regarding ongoing applicability. The prohibition against having sex with a woman during her period does not apply in the new covenant, so they say. And therefore, the prohibition against having sex with one of your own sex doesn't apply either. Let me give it to you just a little more formally. Okay? Because I want you to understand what the argument is, because I'm going to go through and explain why that argument doesn't work. Okay? The proscriptions of having sex with a menstruating woman and engaging in homosexual conduct are sufficiently similar. This is the first premise. That they must be treated the same in terms of applicability under the new covenant. All right, premise one. Next premise, the proscription of having sex with a menstruating woman has no applicability under the new covenant. Therefore, the proscription of engaging in homosexual conduct has no applicability under the new covenant. Okay, that is the argument. Now, as I just noted, the ban on homosexual conduct is applied repeatedly in the New Testament. It is applied repeatedly in the New Testament, so we know for certain that it wasn't a temporary matter restricted to the Mosaic covenant, that it wasn't a temporary Jewish specific element of the Mosaic covenant. We know that from the various arguments and reasons I gave you why it doesn't make sense to think of it as a purely ritualistic matter that applied only to Israel, only during the time of the Mosaic covenant. And then we have that confirmed by the fact that it's repeated in the New Testament. A second bell? Okay, hang just a sec. But I wanted you to see that we know for a fact that the conclusion of this thing is false. Okay, before I dig into it, and that'll be in 2 weeks, and explain a little bit more about this, it's like the argument that all men have red hair, Ashby is a man, therefore Ashby has red hair. Well, you see that I don't have red hair. What little hair I have is not red. So you know without analyzing the premises that something is wrong because it leads to a conclusion that is obviously false. So now the question is where? Either of those premises may be rejected. Okay, neither of the two premises on which this argument hangs can be demonstrated. Okay, so either one of those is where the argument can go haywire. But I just wanted you to see that's the argument. 2 weeks from now, Lord willing, we'll be back. Pick up with the third class. Thanks.